Mecca by Desmond Stewart. Photographs by Muhammad Amin. Newsweek, New York. Wonders of Man. This day is September 25th, 2013. And we want to make it well clear that this is not concerning the Nation of Islam or the Islamic Advent or the Muslim religion. We're not trying to trick ones into listening to the truth. We're only gonna worry about the references to Ethiopia within this book that is all about Mecca. This is concerning Rastafari future and Ethiopia's progress. So we're gonna begin by going forward to page 22. This is actually chapter 2. It reads Arabia before the Prophet. That's the title, and we have a sentence down here that reads, the Queen of Sheba, who visited Solomon, for example, almost certainly ruled in southern Arabia, not Ethiopia, and the ruins of the vast dam built by the Himyarite kings at Marib in Yemen during the lifetime of the Roman Empire still impress us today. We're gonna try not to comment on much. So that being said, we're gonna go forward to page 24. And it reads, another invasion took place in the period immediately before the advent of Islam. According to tradition, in the very year of Muhammad's birth, in AD 570, later dubbed the Year of the Elephant, Abraha, the Ethiopian king of Yemen, advanced north with the intention of leveling the Kaaba, or Kaaba, in revenge for a Meccan defilement of his large church at Sana'a. Legend has it that the invasion was defeated by divine intervention. The king's elephant stubbornly refused to march on the sacred shrine, and as the Ethiopians retreated, a flock of birds pelted them with pebbles. From traditional descriptions of the septic pustules that erupted on the skins of the pelted soldiers, it seems likely that the actual cause of the Ethiopians' defeat was an epidemic of smallpox. This ease was later to prove a recurrent danger to visitors to Mecca. So we're gonna go forward onto page 34. This is chapter 3, The Messenger of God, and it reads, the temptation to link God's eruption into Arabian history with the Yemenite-Ethiopian assault on Mecca proved irresistible to these biographers, which is why tradition puts Muhammad's birth as AD 570, the so-called Year of the Elephant. He may actually have been born a few years later. There's no means of knowing for certain, but we may have confidence in the main facts recorded about his family situation, even if some details are incorrect. So yeah, going forward onto page 44. But Muhammad was not to suffer physical persecution of the sort that, in Paul's case, culminated in decapitation under Nero. Indeed, the sufferings of Muhammad and his early converts have probably been exaggerated from pious motives. For whatever the pagans might have liked to do, Muhammad's connections with the powerful Quraysh protected him and most of his followers from imprisonment, torture, or death. Even so, he found it expedient to send some of his followers into exile across the Red Sea in Abyssinia. There, the Muslims were interrogated by the Ethiopian Emperor Negus on their attitude to Jesus. Their reply was to recite the chapter on Maryam, Mary, which indicated the high respect in which the Quran held Jesus and his mother, Maryam. So now we've leaped over to page 56, and it reads, the ancient house, rebuilt in Muhammad's youth, contained a number of paintings as well as idols and fetishes. According to the historian Azraqi, Muhammad himself stood in front of the representation of Maryam holding Jesus on her lap and prevented its destruction. Open parentheses, it was to perish a generation later in a fire, close parentheses. This story is significant for two reasons. It underlines the respect Muhammad felt for Jesus and his mother, and it indicates that Muhammad felt no particular prejudice against representational art. Ones might assume that this is not referencing Ethiopia, but anything that has to do with Jesus and his mother Mariam has everything to do with Ethiopia. So going forward, we're gonna go to page 83. Alright, this is probably one of the most interesting finds within this book, Mecca by Desmond Stewart, and it reads, page 83, over the centuries, the rites of the Hajjah or Hajj remained essentially the same as those performed by the Prophet, but the buildings and places associated with them were subject to change. The sacred mosque, as the world sees it in modern photographs, is totally different from the structure in existence at Muhammad's birth. For instance, this had been a small, unroofed building, more like a sheepfold than a temple. Its retaining walls were at most 15 feet high and made of rough stone without cement. Within was the well of Zemzem, and without clustered the houses of Mecca's wealthy. By AD 608, when a Byzantine ship was fortuitously wrecked on the Red Sea coast, the Kaaba or Kaaba was in a state of dilapidation. The ship in question happened to carry a man who was both a carpenter and a mason, and with his help and the timbers from the wreck, the Quraysh rebuilt the Kaaba. Both his skills were needed, as the new Kaaba was constructed of alternating courses of stone and wood. A coat of plaster gave it a uniform appearance. The roof was supported by six pillars and the surfaces of these columns, as well as the walls and ceiling, were ornamented with pictures of trees, angels, and prophets. Because the wrecked ship had been on its way to Abyssinia, it is possible that Bakum, the carpenter mason, was an Ethiopian, and that the Kaaba that Muhammad knew and cleansed was decorated in the style of Abyssinian Ethiopian stone churches. So now, to conclude, let us go to page 46. This might not seem to be a reference to Ethiopia, but in fact it is. So there's a description of some kind of carriage that's pretty much very similar to the Ark of the Covenant in a way, you know, in a very general sense, not exactly the same in details, but nonetheless, you know, same functions and stuff like that. So we have here this sentence that reads, it contains nothing but has two mushafs, which is spelled M-U-S slash or dash, my bad, okay, M-U-S dash H-A-F-S, open parentheses, or copies of the Quran, close parentheses, one on a small scroll and the other in the usual form of a book, also small, each enclosed in a case of gilt silver, attached externally at the top. The reason we make mention of this is because we know for a fact that if mushafs is the Arabic for like scrolls or book, we know that the real root, although professors and those people that are authorities, so-called, even though they will completely deny and discredit our opinion or our knowledge, that's exactly what it is. Mushafs is actually a later kind of like derivation of the Ethiopic Metzhaf, and that's the only reason why we brought this forth, although historians and scholars and stuff like that will say that the Ethiopic comes from the Arabic, but that's completely impossible. Edward Ohlendorf, excuse me if we mispronounce his name, he goes into detail as to how, well, he actually builds a case as to how that is not possible and how it is the Ethiopic that is the root. And so we'll leave this at that, just trying to make that connection. And so Yeah, give thanks to all the listeners. Shalom Rastafari.